anyone, you are not below anyone. That's confidence. When you can get to the place in your life where comparison is dead, where you are good enough, not to others, but to yourself, that is confidence. And you can be good enough right now because you are good enough right now. You might just need to change your mindset. Confidence can be developed in many ways. You can start with your physiology, your posture. If I asked you what a confident person looked like, would you be able to tell me? Of course you would. They look strong, sure of themselves. How are they standing? They're standing tall. How are their shoulders? They are back, upright. They make eye contact. Their head is up, not down. Now, a shy or introvert person might say, yeah, well, that's all good for outgoing people, but I will never be confident. Anyone can develop confidence. Some might have to work on it harder than others because they've conditioned themselves into a lack of confidence for much of their life. But anyone can develop confidence. Even the majority of shy people have moments where they aren't shy, like around people they trust, maybe family, friends, or their partner. Moments where they can be themselves fully. So the shyness is selective, which means you can make confidence permanent if you consciously decide to be the person and do the things you do. Not just around those you trust the most, but all the time. Being confident doesn't mean you're loud. It isn't about being the one that has to be noticed. It's the opposite. It's knowing you're great without having to be seen. It's the silent winner. It's the humble champion. If you lack confidence, you can change. If you lack anything, you can change. You can be anything in life, including radical personality change, if you are committed to finding the answers. Unlock the greatest version of yourself, your true nature of confidence, of pure positive energy. Unlock your authentic power today.
So, good morning, students. So, that's a motivational and inspirational talk for you. Let's commence the session. So, we want to recap the things that what we have seen in the last session. So, that can be done through a simple MCQ section. So, respond to me the things in your chat. So what does XML stands for? So here I have not given the option. So we make it as A, B, C, D. What could be the best option? Type it in the chat. Expecting all the people to respond. That shows your presence in the class. So the option could be extensible markup language. The option will be B. Okay. So extensible markup language. So this is the way to write XML too. Second question. What is the correct syntax of the declaration which defines the XML version? What could be your best option? A, B, C, or D. Please type it in the chat. Your corresponding answer. So in the last session itself, we have seen a well-formed XML program. So in the program, we have mentioned the syntax clearly. What could be the best option? Any answers in the chat? Yeah, we are getting answers. Very good. So the option is B only. Next, which statement is true regarding your XML? all the statements are true. Must have a closing tag. XML must be a lower case. All XMLs must have a DTD. So DTD, we are going to see it in today's session. So option would be, so people started setting A, but ultimately the answer is B. Because we have talked about XML case sensitivity, and still we have not come across the term DTD, because in the well-formed program, XML program section, I have shown you, I wrote the program without DTD. Okay. So ultimately, all the XML tags must have a closing tag, because the XML program will be represented as a tree for the browser context. That is the reason why this could be the option. So now it is to refresh your content. Well-formed XML document means, what's your answer? So what could be the option that I could be able to see in the screen? A. So you have A, B, C, D. There are four options. I have received an option A apart from that. Yeah, so that could be the option. Option B, because option D will cover everything. So in the well-formed document, the option D will match all the contents of A, B, C that you could be able to see there. So must contain one or more elements. I could be able to get a child as well as subchild. Root element must contain other elements also, right? So that represents the term child and subchild. So that's the idea. So the option is D. So what's the comment statement in XML? A, B, C, D. What could be the best option? So, and also I'll give you a hint that this XML topic could be your milestone 3 syllabus in your Wipro training session. Okay. So this could be a added value for that. So no need to have a separate session for this. So students who are involving in Wipro training session, I think till last Michael sir have covered for HTML and CSS. So actually XML will come as a last topic only, but no issues. You can learn it from the scratch through this session. So the option could be, able to see any other options. So I'm getting options. So C, number of options is C. Okay, fine. Because the same thing that what we are reflecting in HTML, that's going to be come over here, right? So that's the thing. So these are all the things that we have covered pertaining to XML. Regarding SOA, we have discussed the overall view of all the 5 units, as well as we have seen the block diagram, as well as the components of the architecture, how it was mapped with the service of the respective cloud computing environment. That is also we have seen in the previous session, right? So commencing with today's session, now we are going to see the XML in the context of a database. Actually, XML has been designed for a lightweight database only. Through the nature of its orientation, it has been used to develop some new packages and languages out of it for some specific applications. I have some XML for chemistry, ChemML, right? I could be able to perform molecular structure analysis and mapping through that ChemML. So likewise, I have BioML, very specifically to study some simple living organisms also. For example, amoeba, you could be able to know that it is a unicellular organism. To manipulate and to move over with the complete research on that unicellular body, I could have a separate markup language for this, right? So likewise, so many new things are being emerged out of XML, so that made it to deviate in some other directions. But W3 is ready to consolidate and move forward for the orientation of this XML with respect to web technology strictly. So that's the thing. Might be our internet speed is getting improving day by day. That doesn't mean that infrastructure alone will give you the best connectivity, but also the content what we are porting through this must need to be adapt to that infrastructure. That is the main criteria. See, while we are going to load a website in, while we are learning in 1999-2003, during the period, while we are going to load the website, we won't use HTTP, we will use FTP. Using FTP only, we will be loading a website. So hardly if we open a website using FTP, we will go for a tea break and we'll come back, right? As well as I can't, if I want to see a web page, means file transfer protocol will help me to open a file in the remote system, that's all. So what I will do, I will log in into the remote system of Yahoo. I'll open that home folder, home directory. I'll open it. In that, I will have index.html. If I double click index.html, the index.html will open in my current browser. So this is the way that we have accessed the low-lying internet along with the technology that was available on the day. But nowadays, it is not like that. Simply, we are opening a web browser and we are giving the voice instruction that could able to open a website easily, or I have a QR code to open the website easily. I am not logging into any sort of remote system, right? So servers are being mapped with the underlying service oriented technology. So that's the growth of this. So in that context, people are want to make it this XML to be a lightweight component. For that, they approach this DTD, document type definition. And one more thing, XML is nothing but purely based on semantic aspect. Semantic means it will ready to give the meaning for the data. Okay. For example, I'm going to create a tag name. Within the tag, I'm going to give RIT. Again, I'm going to close the tag name. So what does it mean? What is the meaning of this RIT? So what is the meaning of the tag or the element that what I'm going to prescribe within the tag that could be understood by the tag itself? So that is a reality of this XML. That is the reason why it can be used as a DB, right? So in that case, the preliminary level for approaching a DB is I need to define a data type for this, okay? Because while I'm going to create a table, I need to give the data type for this. So what could be the initial idea? While XML is going to explore, the concept of DTD cannot be directly used in XML. That is the reason why from SGML, where HTML was being derived, SGML, from SGML only the concept DTD was emerged, right? So whatever the data I am going to supply within this tags, that will give me the corresponding data type. Okay, so it is like, so how we are writing a C program, int a equal to 10. So a is a variable of integer data type. Likewise, I could able to give the data type for any data I am going to use, right? We are not going to use any variable. We are going to use the data along with the data type. So for the purpose only, this DTD was being derived from SGML, can be clubbed with the XML and could able to use it. But I could able to tell you the upcoming browsers are ready to negotiate this DTD, because this DTD is derived from SGML. So they want a native interface for this. That is the reason why later stages, by identifying the DTD limitations, people started using nowadays XSD, XML schema distribution, XSD. Okay, so that is the idea behind this, the context of DTD. So DTD represents your document type definition. Ultimately, it is ready to give the type of data what you are going to use within the XML. So that's the thing. So what could be the purpose of DTD? So I'm going to, if I want to give the structure of a XML document, I could able to use this DTD. So we will see the program. So by that, you could able to come to understand, as well as while we are going to form your WFF, well-formed formula for your XML, this DTD will play a vital role. Okay. So every HTML program can have a DTD. Okay, so because I'll tell you a website, xmlvalidation.com. You can visit this website, xmlvalidation.com. You can write your XML program with the DTD or without DTD. You can pass it inside that website, and the website will validate and tell you whether you wrote the XML program correctly or not. It's like an online compiler. right? So we could able to validate it. So the same type of validation feature is available nowadays in all the browsers, right? So during the earlier days, we don't have the like a compiler type or interpreter type. We don't have any translators during the time. So that is the reason why browsers are built in with the parsers for XML. Browsers are started to use parsers for XML. So it could able to ready to parse and generate output. Parsers are nothing but the thing that already you are familiar with the JavaScript, right? So the scripting engine that is being ready to compile and give you, for example, you are going to write a program with HTML, the JavaScript means the scripting engine, what it will ready to retrieve the output from DHTML program, HTML plus JavaScript. So the same type of nature, the XML program is going to get to be executed and you are going to get the output through that. So that type of nature and future is available nowadays in browser itself. But this could be the best platform to check, right? So because even without a proper syntax or even without a WFF, your browser will show you the output. But xmlvalidation.com website will correct and will give you what you are going to post. So these are all the places that you need to change, that it will ready to generate error, but your browsers will not generate error. That is the main thing. Because for example, if you are going to miss stdio.h in your C program, your compiler is ready to respond, function should have a prototype. So likewise, you will get a compilation error, but your XML will not generate, or your XML parsers will not generate like this. You could not be able to identify in which line, in which error. Even for script engine will generate errors through your browser, but for XML, you cannot be able to see the errors. Simply it will parse, right? So that's the drawback of parser in browser. To overcome that only, xmlvalidation.com. If we use that website, you can execute this XML program too, as well as you have some offline editors also, Spy++ or XML Spy++. You have an editor that where you could able to write your programs and you could able to check it out. Pertaining to Wipro Milestone 3 for XML, you are going to be focused only on MCQs. Okay, so learn this theoretical context correctly. You don't have any programs on this. Okay, so that is the idea here. So here I wrote my first DTD. employee.dtd. Okay, so that's the name of the file. So I think you are very familiar with CSS. How you will be using CSS? You'll be writing an external CSS and you will be linking with a HTML program, right? The same way that I'm going to write it externally, employee.dtd is a external DTD that I'm going to link with that. Employee is the root tag. Okay, employee is the root tag. First name, last name, email are the child tags. That's all. So here I am going to use the data type PC data, parsable character data type. That is what PC data. Okay, parsable character data type. Okay, so that's the syntax. So the within that exclamation mark element, root tag, comma, what are all the childs that I'm going to use? Since you are having subchilds that you could be able to define it very easily in employee.dtd. So that is the thing. So again, you have to define each and every child's data type, right? I have given the structure of my root tag. Employee consists of first name, last name, and email. Now each and every subchild must be given with their corresponding data type. That is what given over there in this. First name, I'm going to use PC data. Last name, likewise, I'm going to use PC data. Email, that I'm going to use PC data. So this is the main data type that will be focusing on your syllabus. So some other data types also there from HTML. For by this context, it is enough to know this. Okay. PC data means parsable character data type. Now it is going to be used in my program, XML program. So how to use this? You are going to include only one line, right? So already that you could be able to see this. So doc type exclamation mark. See the second line, doc type employee system within double quotes. I'm going to give the external DTD. If you are going to run it in the local machine, that you have to give the file path here. Okay, advisable, you could able to store both XML program and DTD program in the same folder, then no need to give that file path. Okay, so if you are going to use it in a server, so what you have to give? /employee.dtd. Likewise, you have to do. So from the default location, it will fetch and it will execute. So that's a way to write. already you know the basic structure of the program, the XML program. In that, I have included only one line. So what's the line? So exclamation mark within the angle bracket doc type. Okay, so that is the name of that corresponding file. In that, what I am going to incorporate, I am going to incorporate the employee.dtd. Like Java, I want to correlate here. Advisable is what could be the root name or root tag of the program. That root tag can be given as the file name. When you are going to work with your xmlvalidation.com or XML spy plus to remember ourselves. So likewise, what we will do for Java C, file name.java, Java class name. So to avoid that confusion, so better to save the file name in terms of class name. That's what I'll be suggesting while we are going for training, right? For Java. The same way, I'm suggesting you the doc type, the name what you are going to give, that could be your root tag name. So that file name also can be used same as the doc tag. So that could be the idea for us to remember. See, and I'll be telling you why I have to give this doc type as the same employee. The reason here is that it is going to rise with it when we are going to access some services. So I could not able to find same services with the services with the same name, right? So to avoid that also, this can be used. So while you are going to learn your fourth chapter, you'll be having UDDI. I'm going to identify a service in the thing, nothing but I'm going to identify a phone number in Yellow Pages document, Yellow Pages book. So likewise, I'm going to identify a phone number from the telephone directory. So likewise. So in that context, it could be ready to defer me, right? So once I'm going to fix it up that I could not able to give any other new name for this. That's the idea of doc type. Okay, so please remember this. System could be the keyword. This is a very basic DTD as well as XML program, right? It is enough to execute the XML program. Automatically DTD will be called and it will be get to executed. So that's the thing. And ultimate idea that what you are going to focus here is a single DTD can be used in many files. Okay, so like your XML CSS only, I could able to reuse my DTD, right? I could able to reuse my DTD. Make sure that I cannot able to modify the DTD. I could able to reuse the DTD for any number of files. That means I could able to link this DTD employee.dtd with any number of files. So that's the idea. That's the main point that you need to note regarding this DTD. Now I want to convey you here why we are moving. What made us to invent XSD? This is the point that I want to convey. you could able to see the screen. Check the point number 2. So DTD is completely derived from your HTML. So it is not native to your XML. That is the problem, right? So that's the reason why people have invented XSD. That XSD was entirely written in XML. So that create the nativity, right? So I could able to see. Assume that I could able to convey example here. Initially, while we are going to work with the microprocessor for 8085, I don't want to concentrate anything on issues related to instruction formats. Okay, but while I'm going to work with the 8086 or the Pentium series that I'm going to work with, in that what will happen, I need to create my own opcode for the given instruction. So that is the compatibility issue started rising when people are moving from 8085 to the advanced Pentium architectures, right? So to overcome that case only, people started inventing micro routines for that case. Likewise only, here also, people have invented XSD to overcome the issue of this DTD. The native content could not be available. That is the reason why this XSD was being written over there. So XSDs are completely written in XML. As well as DTD will not support data types. I have shown you, right, PC data, that is the data type. Along with that, you have CD data, that is also available. Apart from these two data types, we don't have any other data types. But in XSD, I could able to give like string, numeric. I could able to give different types of data. Because when you are going to work with any type of data, it must be identified for the purpose of manipulation. That is the reason why data type was introduced, right? So while we are going to use DTD, I can't manipulate the data. Only I could able to display it, right? So that is the drawback of DTD. That is the advantage of XSD that we are going to manipulate. And I am going to show you an XML with the XSD program also. Next, the concept of namespace. That means I could able to create some number of DTDs, and I could able to post it in the single class. Normally, what is mean by namespace? Collection of, like our package in Java, right? Collection of classes. Likewise, I could able to create number of DTDs. I could able to store it inside the namespace. From the namespace, I could able to access namespace.dtd. That type of nature is not available in DTD, but it is available only in XSD. So I could able to create XMLNS. That is the syntax for this. So I could able to give some name, XMLNS colon RIT. So I'm going to create some employee.xsd. So what I could able to do that, RIT.employee. That's all. That will give me the complete XSD. That's the role of the namespace, right? And as well as subchains cannot be cannot be ordered. Okay, what's mean by the order? I could able to change the path. Okay, so I could able to redesign the path. So while we are going to learn about XPath and the XQuery, you could able to learn about this very clearly. Okay, so I cannot able to rearrange the path here, but I could able to access nothing. But what about the order here means, for example, to execute the query, a very big tree is there. Okay, I have to find out the shortest route to reach the child node. Okay, so in that case, DTD will perform only the sequentially, but here I could able to define, for example, A dot, C dot, the final path. That is the shortest route I could able to access, A dot, C dot data. But what DTD will do, A dot, B dot, C dot data, it will come sequentially to access the child path. So if I want to make that order to be changed, it is not possible in DTD, but in XSD, it is possible for me. And the sixth point is very, very important. That's an important feature where XSD was made more available in the market. Extensible, right? I could able to reuse and I could able to extend it. That is the feature of XSD. For example, I wrote a DTD, I wrote a XSD. I wrote a XSD for only 5 tags, okay, one root tag and 4 subchild tags. Now I want to alter that XSD, okay. So in that case, I'm going to add one root tag and 7 child tags. So in that case, I could able to alter it and I could able to use it in some other XML program. That feature is possible, but in DTD, it's not possible, right? Because another reason will come for this, namespace won't support for this, but namespace could able to differentiate an XSD file with a root name with a 5 child tags, root name with a 7 child tags. That is possible for us. And DTD is not simple to learn because it's not a native of XML. I have to put a separate effort of learning HTML. Then understanding HTML, I have to come across with my DTD. Most of us will come across HTML in schooling itself, right? So that's very easy for us. But when the right procedure to learn HTML is, first we have to learn HTML in a proper way, then only we could able to come out that, see, H1 to H6, what is the purpose of the tag, that we could able to know that it's coming big, it is coming small. What is the actual orientation behind that inclusive of the tag? That could be understood only if you are going to learn with your HTML. So without understanding that you are going to use a package which is being derived from HTML is very tough over there. So how many of you could able to remember all the 347 tags in HTML? Could be able to raise question now. Oh, it's very tough for us because we are learning HTML as a set of commands. That's it. We are not learning it as a complete package, right? So we are learning it as a commands only. So without understanding the backward implication of the respective tag, we are learning it. That's the thing. That's the same complex will come for this DTD. But in XSD, it is not like that. You don't need to know new language because everything is based on XML syntax only, right? So that's the thing. And The last difference point is going to talk purely on well-formed structure. Okay, so what about a DTD and a XSD? But still it is in controversy because well-formed XML program till now being validated against DTD only, not against XSD. But the term control is going to talk about the usage of the respective attribute in different XML programs that can be identified. That is the only difference on DTD and XSD pertaining to the well-formed XML program. Okay, so that is the only context that we are going to work with, right? So that is the reason why we are going to learn XSD. Okay, so that's the point that I want to stretch here. So what are all the data types available in XSD? So XML schema. So in that XML schema, that what we are going to work with. So XML schema, data type, XSD type, simple type and complex type. These are all the two data types. So they want to differentiate them. Okay. So if you are going to work only with the text, I am going to use simple type. Okay. I am going to use it as a complete tree. Okay. People who are familiar with the JavaScript on DOM, document object model, the same thought is being applied here. That's it. Right. So I could able to access only the data. I'm going to use simple type. I'm going to work with the tag as well as data. I'm going to use complex type. For example, I want to delete a node. I have to work with the complex type. Okay. I want to delete only the data. I have to work with the simple type. Assume that there is a tree. I want to delete the node. In that case, I have to work with the complex type. I want to delete only the data. That means here the term node represents tag. I want to delete the tag itself. In that case, I have to work with the complex type. I want to delete only the data available within the tag. In that case, I have to work with my simple type. It is an example, right? So likewise, you can go for insertion, replacement. So likewise, you could be able to work with that. That is the reason why in simple type, we have a note on that. It should not be left empty. Okay. So when I'm going to delete a data, that will be replaced with the default data type. If I'm going to delete an integer, means default will be zero. That will be replaced with that. That represents that the data available in the child got deleted. Likewise, in complex data type also, when I'm going to replace, for example, I'm going to delete a string, a name. Okay, so I have a list of 10 kabaddi players. So I'm going to delete the 8th player. So when I'm going to delete the 8th player in the tree, ultimately what is going to happen? That is being replaced with the null. That is a default string of the XML type. Okay, so that is a thing that it want to stretch it with that. So you could be able to see an example XSD here. So I took this program from Java T point. So the copyrights will cover them. And I want to stress here, see that this could be the syntax XS colon schema. The dark black color could be the syntax. Secondary, XML NS colon XS. XML NS is also syntax colon XS. Okay, so up to this, you are going to work with the syntax, which is equal to already they have a schema in other website. See the website, w3.org. It is some other website. Okay, now the XML schema available in the website is going to be reused or extended in the target namespace. Check that attribute, target namespace equal to. I am going to currently use it in my website. My website is www.javadpoint.com. Okay. So the schema what they have used in W3 is going to be used in Java Tpoint. Right. Now I have fixed it. Second. So now I am going to define my current platform using XML NS equal to. This is my current platform. And the element form default equal to qualified. It represents that what I am going to give as a XML program, that must be in WFF. That's well-formed formula based one. That means every tag will be closed. Everything will be in the proper way. The 12 rules, what it was supposed to have in our WFF, the same thing. Okay. This attribute is it's an optional one. Even if you are not going to go, by default, it will take it up. Element form default equal to within double quotes qualified, right? So this could be the syntax like our header file. We have completed header file section. So what I have to do, first I have to mention from where I am going to take the XSD, where I am going to apply, or what I am going to extract and use, what is my current XSD that is going to be given over there. Now, in the second section, you could be able to see here. I am going to define the element here. Okay. So the same way that you could able to remember here, what I did here, the data type that what I'm going to use here is complex data type. Okay. So the root tag has been given in the element through that name. Okay. As well as child tag also given using the same syntax. But the thing is how I am going to define the child tag using the command sequence. That's what the order. Okay. XS colon sequence. Within that only I'm going to give my child tag. Now, along with the name, I'm going to give my data type also. You could be able to see first name belongs to the data type string. which will come under XS. Okay, so that is the thing. So now employee is available inside my the namespace http://www.javatpoint.com. It's a simple way. See this XSD and the DTD that what we have seen in previous one. See this, you have an element. In the element itself, I have defined my complete tree. For every subchild, I have given the data type. But here, you could able to see what I did. I am going to give the declare the element, inform the data type in which sequence it is going to work with. Okay, so that is the point. We are going to mention the data type also here. So please remember. So I have opened the sequence, closed it, opened the data type, closed it, as well as the schema also, right? So it can be linked with my XML file. Okay. So that's the point. You could able to see the same thing here. How I have defined my XML schema, the same way here I have called my schema, right? How I have called my schema using the name that you could able to see here. XS colon element name equal to employee. The same way only I have used my tag here. See that employee. I have given the tag here. Okay. So my namespace was designed from where I have taken that namespace was defined. Right. Further, I have created an object XML schema if an instance current location was being mapped with the XSD file. So that has been given over there. So finally I wrote my program. That's it. That's a very simple program on this XSD and XML. So it's time for discussion. If you have any clarifications, you can raise now.